All right, well, appreciate the opportunity to talk to y'all tonight about threading. Some of the things we're going to talk about is the ABCs of hand thread chasing. We're going to, I'm going to show you some tools that you can actually make to use for threading, some ancillary tools for hand thread chasing, and then toward the end, we're going to demonstrate a homemade Bonnie Klein or Baxter type of threading jig, where one of the advantages of it is it's a short learning curve. Once you get it mastered, you can get perfect threads almost every time in most hardwoods without having to resort to expensive exotics. So why do we even care about threading? You know, threading's been around a long time. I'm not sure. It's kind of a novelty. Frankly, it's not real practical on a lot of boxes other than the novelty. I think a box you just pop the lid off probably just as functional, you know, to be honest. But the threadings are kind of neat, and they intrigue people. So if you give somebody a nice little threaded gift, I mean, they do ooh and ah over it, because it is very impressive when you see it. And it's a lot of fun. That's why I got into it. It's just a lot of fun, and that's what turning as a hobby is all about, is just having fun. So follow, as Lyle Jameson says, follow the fun trail. So I'm going to start off with hand thread chasing, and to get started, I want to show you one of the things they say is very gentle strokes. Now, what does gentle mean to a guy? I don't know. Some people's like more power, you know. Get her done, get it at everything you got. And all I'm doing is truing this candle up. But I thought, well, you know, let's demonstrate that with the candle just to give you a feel for what gentle is. Dave Martin and I had an opportunity here about a year and a half ago to go see Richard Raffin do a demonstration up at Chattanooga. And he used the term, when you're using a scraper, the pressure you use, you're supposed to be gentle, but the pressure you use is about the equivalent of the pressure you put on your hands when you're drying it under a forced air dryer. And I thought, well, that's a really good description. And sometimes we need something very specific that we can relate to on some of these vague terms of damp, moist, wet, what have you. So when you do thread, I'm going to start with the male threads first. My blog spot, I've got a place out there to put any articles or any class handouts that I've prepared on any of the demos I've done, and we got links to a couple of the Gwinnett YouTube videos that I was in. What's that? I like flip charts. They work. So here's a couple of things about threading. The kind of speed we use when you hand chase, somewhere between 200 and 500. It's kind of a personal thing. It really helps if you have a variable speed lathe. Some of the fixed speed lathes don't go any slower than 500, and 500 is a challenge, but maybe doable. Woods, when you hand thread chase, you want a very dense hard wood. Now, you've got some woods that are hard, but they don't have the kind of density that's suitable for it, such as white oak is hard, but it's not generally suitable for hand thread chasing. So most of the woods that are suitable tend to be exotics out of Central South America, Mexico. Some of them come from Africa. Here's some examples. This is a threaded box of black limba. A neighbor of mine had some black limba and gave me. This is a piece of mopani. Bonnie Klein said if she could only turn one wood, it would be mopani. I'd never heard of it before until my son gave me a piece for Christmas. He didn't know anything about it. He just went to Rockler or something, and they said, I want to buy an expensive piece of wood. So they gave him a piece. It's like, what am I going to do with this? And it sat there and sat there. And it wasn't very big. I cut it in thirds when I got in threading, said, oh yeah, I heard this was good for threading, so I cut it into thirds and made a box. Osage orange, that is one of the domestic woods that does thread fairly well. And I think Osage orange can be fairly attractive. Bacote out of Mexico, this is a fairly inexpensive wood that threads well. and some of y'all use it for some of the other wood projects. It's got a very nice coloration to it. I like Bacody. I really expected this box to seize up on me. I turned it when it was green. Anytime when you make threaded boxes, the wood has to be dry. Anything you get out of Woodcraft or Rockler or here that's an exotic that has wax on it, assume it's green, because it probably is, because it's got all that wax on it. So I just wanted to see how it threaded. So I made this nice little box thinking, yeah, a week from now, the lid won't either come off or it won't go back on. But so far, it's been fairly stable. When you do make a box, there's variations, but generally for small boxes, it's a spindle project with the grain running parallel. You want to hollow out the blank just like you do a bowl. You turn it twice. You turn it once when it's green, and the process, if you're going to be making these boxes, generally you want to pick a nice shape or ratio. 1:3 is generally pretty good. Make the main thing is make the walls on the base a little bit thicker than the top. Now why is that? Because it's a tenon and it's got to fit inside, so it's got to have thicker walls. But hollow it out about as deep as you're going to go, and then just let it dry. Throw it up on a. You're going to do a couple of steps though. First thing you're going to do is you're going to turn it round. You're going to put tenons on it. You're going to put it in your chuck, and then you're going to face this off a little bit to remove any signs of damage from your tailstock. Then you're going to turn it around and do the same thing on the other end, which would be this end. Then you part it off at about 1/3, 2/3, whatever you like. Then you're going to rough hollow the lid. That's the sequence. Then you rough hollow the base. And those sizes are approximate, depends on the size of your box. If you're going to put a finial and make it an integral part of the box, of course, make the blank a little bit longer. Then, once you do that, you reverse the two, take them off the lathe, put them together, wrap it up with tape with the open ends out, right, you know, pecan, 9/12, and put it on the shelf, and then let it move and let it dry. And 3, 4, 5, 6 months, 9 months. The key is get a bunch of them out there with different kind of wood so you got a choice. And once you get started in that process, you'll always have plenty of wood, except for the exotics. So I want to show you, these are thread chasers. There's a male and a female. Yeah, just a moment. I'm going to pass the set around. So you got two different operations. For the female, you're going to go in on the inside with a female tool. On the male tool, on the male end, you're going to do it a little differently. I'm going to demonstrate this first just because it's a little easier and simpler, and you can see what's going on. This takes place inside, so you can't really see it. So to demonstrate the gentle, I like to thread at about 300, 330. So having a variable speed with a readout is really nice. And these things have a tendency to want to find at certain speed at certain ranges. So it's whatever is comfortable on that particular lathe. Like mine, it wants to jump to 330. This one looks like it wants to jump to 346. So you start at an angle. You have about a little less than a finger's depth between. And some of y'all were here earlier, you saw me dressing the tool rest. That's real important. This thing's got to be just glass smooth. So I took a file out, filed it off, took some sandpaper, smoothed it down, and then rubbed a little paraffin on it, because you want this thing to glide across. You're going to develop a little motion. You're going to come in with an angle. Let's hope I don't knock the work off here. And then once you get it started, it starts running along. It gets in that groove and just rides along. And those are the kind of threads, the kind of shavings you'd like to get off wood, but you don't normally get it quite that fine. And because this is so soft, I'm skipping one step. We're going to get into it in a little while. But that's soft. That's gentle. And I didn't look to see how deep I was cutting, but actually I've almost got a pretty nice thread. So now we're going to take a piece of exotic wood. In this case, this is a piece of Guncalo alves, otherwise known as tiger wood, which is used in this country for decking.
What makes that track for you?
What makes
you doing that? You have to move at a certain speed each time?
Yes. You have to get it started. Once you get the thread started, then and you're coming in at an angle, and you're just going to strike it and get it started on the very corner. And then with each time, you're going to keep turning it around and getting closer and closer to parallel or 90 degrees. And then once you get it going, it engages the thread you've already cut and keeps you carry it a little bit further and a little bit deeper. And then you just keep at it, developing a certain rhythm. And that's where the skill comes in, is getting that rhythm.
How often do you have to sharpen the tool?
I try to sharpen them about every time I use them. It's a negative rake scraper, so all you're really doing is honing the top of it. So you just give it a few strokes, and we're going to talk about tuning that in just a minute. In this case, that's about as close as I can get, so that's probably... Now I can see why they put this on the other side. And before I get into that, let's do talk about tuning a little bit, and then I'm going to pass this pair. I've got two pair of thread chasers. The threads you get are based on the threads that the manufacturer cuts in here, and I have a 16, which is what I started with, and then I have a 20 threads per inch, which I picked up off the internet used. It works nice for really small boxes. I think Chris especially likes the 20 on some of his acorn boxes. You tune these things, and what by tuning them, they don't. It's like any lathe tool you buy; it doesn't come ready to use and sharp from the manufacturer. You want to grind off a little bit, make it a negative rake scraper, and you don't ever mess with the teeth. All you're gonna do is sharpen the very top, so you have that really two planes meeting at a very crisp angle. You also, like any scraper that you're going to run along a tool rest, you want to relieve or put an aris on the corners. Just knock the sharp edges off. So when it's sliding along, it's less likely to catch any nick that you might have missed, and it'll just slide smoother. So you're going to, you'll see that when you see these. On the female, you also want to knock the edges off of the very top, because once you get inside on something small, you don't want it hanging up or catching on anything when you get that movement going, so take that edge off of that. You also can take this down just a little bit to make it a little smaller so you can get into a smaller opening. So those are all different things you can do to quote, tune them.
How expensive are those tools, Mike? How expensive are those?
I bought my first set, these right here, in June off Amazon for about $65. They list price, so it's probably $79. You have to look around and find a deal if you can get it. Sometimes people want to package it, and that was a problem with Woodcraft. They wanted to package it with some ancillary tools. I can't remember which one. I think they had Sorby has a really nifty little gauge. About $40, and they packaged it with it, I think, and it made it like, no, I don't want to buy their package because I don't want to spend the money for this little gauge when I can do it without the gauge. But the list price, the Crown makes a set. Hamlet, I understand, makes a set. I've never seen any. But Crown and Sorby is the easiest to find, but Crown also makes some. There's also a one, Ashley Isles makes one, but you got to get it from Great Britain. I've never seen anybody in the United States that sells it. And it's a version that looks a little bit like the female, except it's not a negative rake, and you turn it upside down to do the male thread. The only thing is, it'd be hard to do that with this center. So if you've got any blocking here, it would make it difficult. And it's a non-standard way of doing it. It's about half price because you only have one tool. So I've already prepared this, but this is one of the ancillary tools that I made. And this is a great little tool. You've probably seen articles or read about it. It's a pyramid tool. Can you focus that? It's got three faces on it, and in effect, it's a scraper. It is a spear point tool for cutting little grooves for burn.
You have to have a rounded edge to come in, but you don't want to hit it into a corner because
and
you're just not going to get a smooth
great
entry.
On threading. And like any scraper, about center height, with in this case pointed slightly down. And you just get that rounded edge, which I already put on it. You also use it for a relief. And you can see that relief a little bit on that illustration, but I'm going to explain what it's for. You put this relief at the end of the cut. If you don't, think about it. You're coming along here with your threading tool, and then what happens? Bam! You're going to hit this wall. Now, the wall just may be the wood that hasn't been cut, but it's going to stop. And then it's gonna quit moving, and when it quits moving, it tears out all your threads. And that's the whole trick to this, is getting that rhythm of being able to keep it moving and get it out of there before it hits the wall. So we're gonna go back down to somewhere like that. Bringing it in at an angle. And then slowly traverse it around. As I start laying more tracks. Some people use an over grip. But your right hand is definitely doing all the work. The left hand is just, it's a place to set it while you're doing this. Like I said, this is just a piece of decking my neighbor had, this tiger wood. Some of it's very bland looking, but some of it's got some nice color. And it makes it threads fairly well because it is very dense and it is very hard. But it's getting that rhythm.
Mike, what's your point of contact? I mean, monitor, it looks like you're underneath.
No, I'm right at close to center. I might be a little bit below, but not much, because it's a negative rake scraper. And that's the motion.
Mike, when you first start, are you consciously moving the tool side to side?
Yes, you have to develop that initial speed, and you're guessing at what that speed is to engage a cut. Because if you go too fast, you'll double up, you'll have a tendency to cut two threads on almost on top of each other. If you go too slow or the lathe is too slow, you'll have, if you go too fast or too slow and you're not cutting, you're gonna crumble up your threads.
But after you get started, it almost becomes self-feeding.
It does become self-feeding, as long as you're gentle and have the right, develop the right touch. It is amazing, though, once you get it, the rhythm of it, how easy it seems to work. But like a lot of things, some people, what's easy to some people, hard for the other. This one looks like it's developing a bit of what I'll call a drunken thread, because I was going a little slow. Instead of it being perfectly concentric, it'll get to a certain point and then just kind of get an angle on it. The thread will kind of change direction a little bit. So you can see that in here, and it looks like it was hitting some particularly hard hard wood. That's not a perfect thread, but that's just a just as an illustration.
So it won't work? I mean, I wouldn't work it yet.
Oh, if I kept working with it and cut it deeper and recognized what it was, but as it got deeper, maybe it would clean some of that out. Sometimes you'll have problems when you chase, but you can work through them. Now, if y'all have heard that joke about the guy that was the professor was on his lecture tour, and he and his chauffeur were going around all these lecture points, and he was talking about dinosaurs and PhDs in the soil and all this stuff. And after a while, his chauffeur says, "Professor, you're making all these big bucks. I can do what you're doing. I've heard this so many times, I can give that lecture." So the guy says, "Okay, let's do that. I'll wear your hat, you put on a suit next time, and you give the lecture." So the guy's giving a lecture, doing a great job, and finally someone did, "Are there any questions?" And the guy in the back of the room says, "Yeah, if you're drilling down 15 feet and you hit a dinosaur, what's the pH of the soil?" The guy just kind of looks at it and says, "You know, that's just about the dumbest question I've ever heard. That question is so easy, my chauffeur in the back can answer that question." So Chris Woodall is my chauffeur, so if you got any questions I can't answer, I'll refer them to Chris. All right, so now I've prepared a blank out of catalogs, so we're going to go ahead and...
How tight can you end up with the threads when you're done? I notice on the acorn there's a lot of play in there.
Well, get
tighter than that, or should you not try it?
You don't want to get too tight, because if you do, wood still moves seasonally. And if you get it too tight, it's liable to rub or cross thread. So you want it a little bit of play. And a little bit of play works, because it's just like putting a chuck up on your spindle. Once you face it off, it's going to lock tight. So a little bit of play is a good thing.
Well, let me ask you something. Do you find that the oily woods work better?
It's a hard question. That is such a basic question. What do you think, Chris? Do you find it works better with oily woods?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. The Osage orange, when it gets at a certain age, it just crumbles, and it's one of the better ones whenever it's right at that perfect stage. Now, where is that at? It's whenever it's you're getting them. Whenever you start into it, you start getting a little shade and the curly coming off of it.
And then you mentioned a time you had some ebony and you were wiping it down with acetone and you wound up wiping out some of the oil, and when you wiped out the oil, it didn't thread more than darn.
It wouldn't thread at all. Actually, it was African blackwood, and that's one of the better ones, and I sprayed it, putting a CA finish on it, sprayed it with a spray, and it wouldn't take a thread for nothing. I thought I'd lost my mind.
But then you look at some of these woods that I say are okay. Mountain laurel, I don't think it's got any oil in it. Dogwood, I don't think it's got any oil in it. Bradford pear, I don't think it's got any oil in it. They're not the best, but they will thread. And Osage orange, I never would have thought of that having oil in it. I don't know, but I guess maybe it does. Boxwood, I don't think has any oil in it. It's just very, very dry, very, very dense, very slow growing. And wood that's not up there, a guy sent me a box of it from, saw me posting about threading on the internet, and sent me a box of mountain mahogany, which grows in the desert at high altitudes in the southwest, and it's very, very dense, very, very slow growing. And you don't want interlocking threads, so wood like
grain,
grain and curly, anything that doesn't thread well, because the thread, when it hits it, it doesn't know what to do, and it has tendency to follow some of the hard stuff. So we put the lid in there. The first thing we're going to do is try to tune it up a little bit. Make sure we have a square surface parallel. Bear with me here. So I've got this particular scraper. This is a Windsor design. Anybody recognize that expensive tool manufacturer? Comes from China in a set from Harbor Freight. So I repurposed some tool, I don't remember which one it was, probably a scraper, and sharpen the end of it, and then cut a little bit of a relief on the side. So I'm going to come down this wall to make sure that it's true and that it's that the walls are parallel. So to do that, I'm going to have to angle this a little bit because that's where I'm cutting, and it's taking a turn right here, as you maybe you can see. You gotta be careful when you get near the bottom that you don't hit the wall. Now there's a couple of ways to tell whether it's parallel. For some of these things, or if you're in production mode, you could use Forstner bits, especially I think on smaller items. Bigger items, I just don't like to use them. I think there's better ways to do it. One way is you get these inside calipers and you can kind of, you know, put it inside and this works well for any kind of box, and then kind of push it back, say, is it getting snug or is it getting loose going in and out? The way I like to do it is, let me get my air compressor here. Is once you think you got it square, you just take a little short ruler or you do a pencil and just push it up flat and then see, is it lined up with the bedway? And that's pretty close, and that'll do it. If it's cocked this way, which is generally the tendency, because as you get deeper, a lot of times you don't push quite as hard. You got to go back in there and just kind of be a little more conscious, take a little more wood off the back. Now, just like we did the relief on the male, we've got to do a relief on the female. And you can buy these relief tools. Sorby makes them, Crown makes them. Sometimes they make them in this kit. Or you can just do what I did. You just use a Allen wrench. All you're doing is cutting off maybe an eighth of an inch in the back and cutting a little groove at the very bottom of the box. Yeah, it can be a little chattery. Okay, got a nice relief back there. Now we're going to take our point tool again, and we're going to round off. We're going to do two things. The first thing we want to do is we want to make sure that we got it faced off with a very slight chamfer, so when it fits together, it won't bind in the back before it binds in the front. Then we're going to round off the edge a little bit, so when we engage, we won't have a sharp edge to deal with. You can see these shavings. This is nice stuff. This is oily. Still got a little bit of a... All this does is tell me which end to blow in, because this end gets kind of nasty.
You should use some red tape around one end or something.
That would do the same thing. It just wouldn't look as elegant. All right, the other ancillary tool that some people like, Chris doesn't like to use them. Some people don't. It's not essential, but for the old-time masters, Bill Jones and Alan Batty, say that... this is indispensable. People have shown it's not indispensable, but for me, I find that it does help. It's called a armrest, and it gives you a little platform, and you can alter it a little bit, but it gives you a little easier motion when you get to going. What I like to do is stick the tool in and kind of gauge how far back, you know, in there I can go. In this case, it looks like I can clear the whole thing.
Is that going to cut on the push or on the draw?
Push. You're only going to lay tracks from the corner. So you can see from that illustration, we're going to start at kind of an angle like that, and then we're going to start working it on in. And we're going to push it in, then we're going to pull it out. And it kind of works, some people call it a figure eight. I think of it as kind of like an oval track. You're going to kind of come in like this and then come out, in and out, in and out, in and out. Sometimes it helps to kind of get a little motion going. You can just kind of hear it and kind of tell it's just, yeah, and once it gets in that groove, it's going. And I'm looking to make sure that once I've got all those tracks laid, that the cutting edge is pretty much parallel with the bedway, because I don't want the threads to go point in or point out. Now those are the kind of shavings you'd like to get. A lot of that is a function of the wood and also how sharp, but those are nice, wispy kind of shavings. Sometimes when you get just a lot of dust, it's an indication that you may not be getting as good a thread as you'd like.
So you got your groove in the base there, but how do you really know when to pull your tool away and not run into the back?
Experience. But like I said, the first thing I did was stick it all back.
Yeah.
And then I kind of see where that point is on the tool, and then I stop before I get to that point.
Well, you can start at the bottom and come out and have the left hand direction. There you go.
This is the fun part. This really is kind of fun. I mean, you kind of get in the zone and you just kind of sit there and do it. Now, I know it's probably as exciting to watch as watching paint dry or watching somebody holler. But bear with me here while I...
We'll accept your word for that.
Yeah, you know, everybody got a different thing. And you want your threads to almost come to a point, but not quite, because once they come to a point, you have a tendency to start crumbling them. But you want clearly defined threads, and I think these are looking pretty good.
Will that stop cutting if you hit the bottom of the groove?
It'll just start crumbling. I mean, when you hit the bottom, you got that sharp edge, and you get the bottom, and it just, once it gets there, it just starts. At least that's what I've been told.
Yeah, right.
Let me give it one more pass.
One more
pass. Yeah, the final cut here. Okay. And I'm not going to do anything with the shape of the box. I'm going to focus on getting some threads done and not make a perfectly beautiful box. Now what did I do? Yeah, thank you. Now the next trick is you got to start matching that size. And the way you do that is with a pair of calipers. Now, there's a couple of techniques for doing this. The one technique, I'm just going to tell you what I do. You just measure the inside, and I look at the millimeter, and it says 31, and I add two more millimeters to it. And that gives me a point of departure. That's probably thicker than I need, but it gives me some room to get in the groove, and then I can bring down the threads a little bit more to make it fit. So.
So you're measuring to the top of the threads?
I'm measuring to the top of the threads. Okay. So I'm measuring just a hair over 31, so I'm going to go to 33. Don't let me forget that number.
With that measurement, that's the difference between your major and minor thread?
No, not really.
His 2 millimeter gives you 1 millimeter of engagement.
Okay, yeah. Same thing.
Okay.
The outside.
Explained it.
Okay. So I'm marking that roughly on the outside to see about how far down I got to go. And I'm going to eyeball it and then just kind of sneak up on it. Actually, I think I'm gonna use a parting tool because that's just a safe, convenient tool to do this with. Start with just a little bit, measure that, and then when I get that right, I can get the rest of it to kind of fit. And that's 35, so we're getting close.
You ever taper your threads?
Sometimes. Sometimes by design.
Sometimes not.
Well, I'll give you an example. The female and the male thread by using the thread chasing. What if you do something really small, like you want a 1/4-inch thread? Well, obviously that female tool won't get in there, so you tap it. And Bob Aldea was nice enough to give me a 1/4-inch tap a while back. So you drill a hole and you tap it, and then you take your exotic wood and you just chase the male thread. And it's got just, when you see it, when I pass it around, you'll see it's got just a little bit of a taper. So it goes in there before it engages.
You got to use a tap, well, wouldn't you use the dye?
I don't have any dyes.
Yeah, that quarter's dye. Oh,
okay. But what's the fun of that?
Seems a lot simpler to me.
Yeah.
The problem with dyes is you got to have them.
You got an old set. Why is that?
Come down about 2 millimeter. I find millimeter is a lot easier for me to work with because it's a small unit and it's easy to do the math in your head because all you got to do is read it. I'm just using the corner of this parting tool to get it squared up. And sometimes you just gotta fuss with it. And I'm eyeballing it to make sure that I've got a nice parallel tenon. All right, one more millimeter. Okay, that's going to be close. Now I've got to do that relief cut in the back. You can use these point tools for that, or you can use a skew. I just didn't recognize it. So I've got a skew made out of the same kind of stock, 5/16 of an inch, and it's easy to get in with this, easier than a regular skew, and you just go straight down on the end, and then kind of come in from the side. Now, an alternative to that is to just use a narrow parting tool. Now, a while back, some of y'all were at the party when David was nice enough to give us a goodie bag, and one of them was this big lump of plastic. He sells for about $10, and it sat there in my drawer, and sat in the drawer. And the other day, I looked at it and said, I need to use that. I need to put it on a handle. What do I need to put it on? What handle do I need to put it on? My narrow parting tool. This is the Penn State parting tool that you can order through the store. It's a real bargain for a parting tool, high-speed steel, even if it's Chinese. But it gives you a really good grip to it. The directions are kind of funky. It says you put it in water, I think, at 200 degrees. I'm thinking, boy, that's real close to boiling. Then you put your hands under cold water. It's like, wait a minute. They're going to tell me I'm going to grab this hot thing, and you do. But it works. So you can use a thin parting tool and do the same thing. Now, some people think the aesthetics of doing a square recess is not quite as nice, but each his own. So we're back to taking that rounded edge. And I know this is too thick, so I'm going to wind up cutting the thread several times. Nope, that's right on the money. I think that'll be good. So we're going to use the mail tool. Here's another little, I put this little relief here to give you a little more room depending on what you're turning, maybe. Didn't you tell me to do that?
Yes,
yeah.
Whale tail.
Whale tail. Okay. Now. Getting that initial cut, then you start slowly bringing it around, parallel, one thread length at a time. Then you get all the tracks laid. Now this is short, so I got to get in there and get out real fast before I hit the wall. I think I'm maybe probably go just a hair higher. Oh, look at those shavings. Isn't that nice? You see them? Little bitty whispering. Little angel hairs. And I'm pulling that thing out, Bob, when it's less than 1/16 of an inch from the edge of the wall. But once you get in the rhythm, and you got to pay attention. And you don't want to drink coffee right before you do it.
Two or three of them.
Probably helps if it's not all bloated.
You gotta be relaxed.
There's a guy named Sam Angelo that goes with the name of Wyoming Woodturner. Anybody ever looked at any of his videos out there on YouTube? He did a whole series of these. I think his video is the ones that got me excited about doing it. He's got about 7 or 8, 10, 15 minute videos on everything you'd want to know about thread chasing.
What's his name again?
Sam Angelo, but it's Wyoming Woodturner. But if you go out to Google, out to YouTube, and probably do a search on thread chasing, he's about the only guy that'll pop up. There's not a lot out there on thread chasing.
You're not out there yet?
What's that?
We'll be now.
You're not out there yet?
Oh, if you do a Google search, my name will pop up. But not on YouTube. We're thread chasing. Alright, now I've got a few threads cut. I can see flats, so I know they're not deep enough, but just to kind of do a sanity check. No, it doesn't look too bad. But I think I'm going to have to take it down. So what you do, when it's obvious they're too high, you come back with your point tool and you just crank up speed a little bit. And just kind of take the top off a little bit. Make sure you're doing it parallel. But don't take it all the way down. What you're doing is just taking the top off, but you're still leaving the tracks. You've already got legs. You've already done the hard work.
You always do the cap first?
Always. That's the way I do it. You could do it either way. If you're doing a threading jig, sometimes there's reasons for doing it the other way. But the female is the hardest to do. And the sequence is... for doing a threaded box, it's just like doing a regular box. And if the lid is going over top, they always tell you to do the female first. If I really screwed this up, all I got to do is hollow a little bit deeper or make not as tall a box and just pull my threads further down. But if you go the other way and you screw up female threads, throw it away, start all over again. So this approach does give some recovery room if you really screw up.
Which is a limb, which is a bottom. Is that one limb?
Whoop, hit the wall one time. Now these threads could be tapered a little bit to the outside and it'd still work. You know, this would fit in and be kind of loose before it engaged, and that's okay. All these threads have flats on them, so I gotta get them down close to a point. This is where we all sing Kumbaya. Right?
Then you cut off the extra three threads when you're done?
You can. Unless they're tapered, and then it doesn't matter.
It
San Angelo on one of his, he did this, and he did a trial fit, and like, bam, first time, right on the money. It made him look real good. He looked real shocked. He says, you know, it doesn't normally happen like this. Now, we're starting to thread. Now, in the interest of time, I could keep playing with this thing and get it all the way down, and I think I'm going to get it where it will fit. But the more you practice, the luckier you get into a full box, and I think y'all get the technique. Because we're getting real close there.
Why don't you put CA glue on the threads?
I don't. Okay. You do it after you, if you do it, after you've cut the threads pretty close and put the CA on it and then let it dry and then come back and clean them up maybe one time. Is that how you do it, Chris?
Yeah, but CA is not good. It's an abrasive in there. It's bad on the tool.
So you don't recommend it?
No.
I just don't like this stuff. I don't like the smell of it, and it's...
Do you wax your threads?
Yeah.
Yeah, I usually do. That's a good technique. That was the other reason I brought the candle.
Candle's right here.
Yeah. Candle's good for a couple of things. Number one, you know, you run it up and down here. When you're real close and it's just fighting you just a little bit, but it might be a fit, it helps to put a little candle wax on there. And see if it'll thread on.
Or channel locks.
that won't work.
Sure it'll work.
Rip out your threads. All right, let me check my notes, see where we are. A couple other things I want to talk about before we get into the jig. Synthetics. Besides turning wood, corian. Actually, I think I have a sample here, if I can find it. Oh, yeah, I never did pass these around. Here's some samples I want to pass around. One of them is a piece of corian, and this is made as a threaded insert to put on an urn. If you're doing an urn in a wood that won't hold a thread, you just make an insert and put on it. There's a box in here that's 10 threads per inch that's done on our threading jig. Here's a piece of plastic. I glued up, I don't know what kind of plastic it is. It was some kind of big floor tiles for a dance floor. It had lights on them, so it was real strong and fairly hard, but it wasn't going to shatter. And I glued up a bunch of them, and it cuts threads real nice, if you can stand the smell. PVC, people said, oh yeah, you can practice on PVC, it threads real well. I don't know why you'd want to practice on a piece of plastic. I mean, you want to practice on wood. You like my old drill sergeant says, train the way you're going to fight. But you can thread, and it will thread for whatever it's worth. This show is an illustration of some woods will surprise you. I said oak is just not real good to hand chase. Guess what? I hand chase this. And some of these are just practice pieces. They've no real use. It's only as an afterthought. When I got a pretty nice thread, I was like, yeah, let's go ahead and finish and make a box. And then reach around for whatever wood you can find and hit. Because I didn't have any more oak, I just was doing the male threads maybe, and then turned around and used some dogwood for a top. And when you do play with these things, be gentle with them. Make sure you know they're turning, because they will cross thread. This is a piece of Burmese blackwood, just real pretty wood. And when you get something nice like that, the 20 threads per inch works pretty well. Y'all have seen this before. This is ebony and Osage orange. No, I've tried mountain mahogany, but I hadn't had any mesquite or ironwood come my way yet. But I'm anxious to try everything I can get hold of. This is a mountain mahogany. When this goes around, look at it, you'll see there's this big notch here down at the bottom. As I was parting it off with a Nick Cook parting tool that I was just learning to use, it just went BAM! It dug in and caught and shattered the box. Now, some people would say, oh, yeah, you could fill that in. You know, you coffee ground list. No, it's got a big crack on it. To me, it's not worth repairing. It's just wood. Throw it away and get another one. But I kept it just for that purpose. I was able to glue the missing piece back on it. But it was going to be a nice box until I ruined it. But I wouldn't try to salvage something like that. Oh,
what's the purpose of the string?
What's purse string?
The purpose of the rope on there.
Just so I don't lose it. And it supports it. It does support it. So when you're here, you know, if you had a bigger one or a longer one. But mostly, this is an old technique. Turners back in the old days when these things were much more fussy, a lot of times it's just like turning your tool rest around, but without having to fuss with it. So they just reach this out and make it their tool rest, and they did it for a lot of operations on a lot of different turnings. Now you can buy these tools, but all it is a piece of steel of some sort. It could be flat, it could be round, it could be forged. But Richard Raffin in his book showed a picture of one made out of carriage bolt. And I thought, yeah, okay. So I made one, and his carriage bolt, I think he suggested, it was a big one, I think it was a half inch. Took a lot of grinding, and then I got to using it, I thought, no, it's too big. It's just real awkward. So I thought, well, it doesn't take a lot of support. You're not overhanging it much. You're not putting a lot of pressure on it. So I went with a 5/16 inch, and that worked out a lot better. This is the head of the bolt. You just grind everything else away. This is not necessarily the best one, but it was an idea that he had, and that I could figure out I could do that. But there's other, probably better ways to make them. But, you know, it's not something you use a whole lot and save money. To me, it was worthwhile making one. So the other things you can do with the threads besides just boxes and urns, as I say, if you're getting to an urn, and let's say you were doing the finial out of a piece of walnut. Well, walnut is not on the list of woods that are suitable for hand thread chasing. But what you could do is turn a tenon on it, and you make a insert with a male thread that you glue on. And you do the same thing if you're doing an urn out of something that you not suitable for threading. You make a little insert, and you make a little flange for it to seat on. And then you can do it a couple of different ways. You can do the whole operation separate, where the insert and the male and the female pieces are both done separately off, and then you fit them to your piece. If you've got a big lathe and this item is running true, you know, you might be able to thread it directly. If you've got a great big one, and when you chuck it up, maybe it doesn't run true, and it's going to be a little harder to cut threads in it. So sometimes it's better to go ahead and cut the flange, make your insert, and then glue it in, and then you don't have to worry about it as much of it being off true. But you could do that insert as Chris showed you. You could make it out of epoxy. Here's a little Akron box with walnut with a Bradford pear insert or dogwood. Bradford pear dogwood. And then the box is maple. The threads didn't cut real well, but well enough to not have to do an insert. So any questions on anything up to this point? All right, I think I covered everything down to our threading jig. Leaf cuts, stems, feed. Yep.
Hey, Mike.
Uh-huh.
The catalog's wood, does it cut in the excellent woods or in the okay woods?
Excellent. Mm-hmm. Not as good as African blackwood or boxwood.
Are those sort of ranked?
Sort of. I think I sort of. Yeah, blackwood and boxwood are two of the best. Lignum vitae is very good. I've done a little piece and it worked. Mopani seemed to work well. Bacot's done pretty well, but it's not as nice as blackwood or boxwood. Cocobolo, I haven't done a box. I've just practiced on smaller pieces, but it's oily and it's hard and dense and it does fairly well. And Osage orange, you get a little more variation, I think, with the Osage orange, because you got to find a piece that's neat, clean, doesn't have any little pinholes from branches or anything there, but it does pretty well, and it's a pretty wood for a box. And this mountain mahogany is just, I think, it's going to be real nice. I got about a shoebox full of it. I made the guy that sent me the wood a threaded box for the nice gesture he made. And there's others that aren't on that list. And there's woods you go into. someplace like Woodcraft that sells some of these bigger turning blanks, and you've got wood you've never even heard of. And some of it, it's like, okay, that's not too bad. Let me buy a piece and experiment with it. And that's where the Bacody and the Zapote, there's another one I got that's done pretty well. All right, let's move this threading jig out. How's this thing roll? No, I think we're just going to move, if I can maneuver this thing, we're just going to move, do it from this side. Yeah, that'd probably be better. But it only goes sideways.
Oh. That's why you're doing it.
Yeah, there is a method to this. This was a collaborative effort of Bob Black and Bob Aldea and myself, mostly Bob, on the design. And you know, it's kind of like ants rubbing the antenna. When they got to get into the engineering part of it and talking about some of this stuff, it's like, ning, 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 and I just kind of watched. And I said, there's nothing I can add to this. So, but source some of the parts. I sourced some of the parts that kind of got us started. And the goal of it was, let's make a threading jig. We saw a film, McMullen or McMullen? I can't remember.
McMullen.
Who demonstrated birdhouse ornaments a while back here, did a demonstration at Chattahoochee on a threading jig that he had made, and he does urns commercially. He's got a business and got several employees, and they crank out a lot of urns. And they thread the top of the urns. They typically use, for an insert, white oak, and they make a collar so you can see it. And customers like that because they can see the grain, they can tell it's wood, it's not plastic. They could buy more expensive stuff like African blackwood that would look really beautiful, but it looked like plastic. And some people, they found customers didn't like that. They liked to see the grain and know it was real wood. So he made a threading jig and he demonstrated it. And it was like, oh, that's kind of interesting. It was like, yeah, you could probably make one of those things. I'm not an engineer, and some of that stuff was probably a little over my head. But one of the things that I was thinking about, well, if we could make one where you didn't have to machine anything and get it from off the shelf parts. And I found that if you use a spindle adapter from Penn State, you can get two different Penn State adapters, and you can get a 10 threads per inch coarse rod, or you can get a 16 threads per inch coarse rod, and those are both readily available, and the adapter will just thread right on, so you don't have to do any machining. Problem is, you've still got coarse rod. It's not like you got this fine machined piece of steel, but it does work. It really does work. So you get this adapter. I think we ordered some here through the store because Penn State has the cheapest ones. In the design, you've got this arbor that's fastened down with these two mounting bolts, and you've got just a little bit of a recess here, so it locks in. It keeps it, you know, real strong in there, and you can interchange it. So we can lift this one out and we can put a 16 thread per inch instead of the 10, each with its own adapter. You have a lock nut here that acts like the face of your spindle. When you screw it down, it hits that nut to keep it secure. You put a handle on it. You can put a round handle or you can put a crank on it. There's a nut embedded in the front and back. And then you have this cross slide traverse mechanism that's operating with a piece of quarter inch threaded all thread. And then this wheel has got these very nice calibrations on it. Bob, when I was trying to figure out how to calibrate mine, what it is, you could do the math with 20 threads per inch. It's pretty easy to figure out that one complete revolution is 500s, yeah. So it's easy to calibrate. Then it's like, well, how do I come up with a strip, these calibrations on here, if I don't have some CAD program, I can just punch in numbers and boom, it spits it out. And I thought, well, I'll use an Excel spreadsheet. I can do that. So I just put on little numbers and notches, one row of notches and one row of numbers. I measured this wheel and made it approximately 8 inches in circumference, which is about the width of a piece of paper. I could print it out, cut it, go downstairs and trial fit it, and it's like, oh, what number did it land on? Oh, I'm off about 10%. Go to Excel, use that feature that says shrink it 10%. Do it again and get almost right on the money. So you can make you a nice calibrated calibration. And the calibration is important because in this case, instead of doing it by hand, you have this high-speed steel rotary cutter mounted in the headstock, and this is what's cutting the threads. And then you put your piece here, and as you crank it in, you cut the threads. So we're going to go through that operation. And then you have this stop block here to register it in case you have to move this out of the way.
Where do you buy the rotary cutter?
You can get them from Bonnie Klein for about $45. You can get them from Best Wood for somewhere around $45, because they're the one that sells the Baxter threading jig. You can get it from Enco for, I think, $23 plus shipping, $24,
$28. For the cutters, $23 or $26?
$23, $26 plus shipping. This is a great project to collaborate on because you can spread the shipping costs over three people. You really cut your costs quite a bit. And then these collets, the collet was like $8 plus shipping. They're fairly inexpensive, a little 3/8-inch collet. You can use a Jacobs chuck, but then this thing sticks out here a long ways. And if you're doing it on a mini lathe, pretty soon you got the cutter sitting out here, you got your jig sitting out here, and you got a big box. You just don't have a lot of maneuver room. So, and the collet is nice and secure, and it's held in place by Bob's got this very nice draw bar. You got a knockout bar?
Use the index pin too.
Oh, okay. Anyhow, he's got this 3/8-inch. Yeah, 3/8-inch rod that fits in the back of the collet and pulls it tight and secures this cutter. So let's get started. We're gonna. Now this is gonna be a two-step operation. Some of it I'm gonna do on this lathe, and some of it I'm gonna do on the other lathe, just because it's faster and easier to do it that way. And we handle that by, this is 1 1/4 by 8 threads. That's 1 inch, but that's all right because I've got an adapter so I can use this on my Powermatic and then unthread it and use it on my Jet Mini. So we're going to put this on here and take a box blank. What this is. Bradford pair. So we go. Do the female thread. This piece wasn't very big, so I just cut this little bitty groove, and as long as you engage the lip in that groove, it'll hold it nice and tight. You just gotta kind of eyeball it and make sure you're getting the lip in there, yeah, before you tighten it up. Alright, so first thing I'm going to do is true this up, just like the other one. Easily fixed.
Let it get in.
See how fast you can spin it.
Mm-hmm. Lights on, so it'll work. Okay. All right, so we'll up a little bit. Again, we're going to angle this a little bit because I'm looking for a straight line here. Go in here, get these walls nice and true. You notice I've got it under my elbow to give it a little extra security. Because scrapers sometimes can get away from you. I've heard. And we're going to do our relief cut. Now, it's not as important to do a relief cut with this cutter, but if you don't, what's going to happen is you're going to get to the end of the wall with this thing, and you're going to start scratching the wall and burning it, and then if you got a nice finish in there, it does interfere with that. So it's still nice to put a relief cut. So the thread will cut nicely into the relief cut and then stop. You still want to have a little bit of a relief. And I want to check, make sure I got it square again. So we're going to use the ruler trick again. In this case, it looks like it goes in just a little bit, so I want to come back and hit it one more lick, a little deeper. A little emphasis more going toward the back. Check it again. And right on the money. Then you're still going to, even with that rotary cutter, you want it to go into a rounded shoulder. So you're still going to come around here, get around. And you still want to take this opportunity to face off your box just a little bit. Give it just a little bit of a chamfer. Now, we take our super duper wrench. Let's see if I can disengage this. There's one. There we go. Don't let me forget the spindle adapter when I leave. Okay. So now we take this and transfer it over here. Okay. Okay. Now this is one of the tricks we figured out. If you have a power drill and you put a little nut driver on it, you can put that on here and just go bzzz and spin it. Now Bob originally had the Cadillac version designed where it was going to have a gross mechanism to move it in place, but that seemed a little complicated for me. So we opted for one a little bit simpler, but. This is jatoba, very hard wood. It was dry. Some of the refinements in it, he's got two gib screws with a shim in here, so you can keep it all snugged up and take the play out of it, which is real important. Now, this is going to come out in American Wood Turner in either the April or June issue of how to make one of these things. I'm working with the guy that's doing the review on my article as we speak. Okay. Doesn't have enough movement to get to the back wall, so we'll just cut it on the front wall.
Does that have an adjustment to make that parallel to the ways on
there? That's part of the design when you build it. You make the piece that fits in the bottom just fit in there, and you line it up. So we're going to get this thing in here. Actually, I don't need to move that.
You cut the threads like that. Are you cutting the threads on the side towards you or away from you?
My preference is to have them cut on the back side, but with this size box, it won't fit.
Did you bring your tool backwards then?
Huh? Hold that. Think about that a while and then get back to us. What's that?
When you tightened it up, that deck raised up on you.
I haven't fastened this down yet, so we will clamp it down before we get going. So you bring this thing in till it just touches the cutter.
On the
the screen, it looks like he's cutting on the bottom, but he's actually on this.
I'm on the side. So now it just touches. So now we back it out.
What size cutter are you using?
This is a 3/4 inch, and I can give you the part number. It's a called, I think it's called a double angle, double angle 60 degree okay. rotary cutter.
So they do come in different degrees.
Yeah, there's all kinds of stuff out there.
They probably do, but that's about all we've got.
This is what you want, is 60 degree. This is high speed steel. I think somebody sells them, it's not, but. All right, so this, got this locked down. Got that locked down, ready to go forward. Now, now we're going to move this thing in by 0.035, which is approximately the depth of one thread. By experimentation by people other than us that have done this for a living, they figured that out for wood threads, for 16 threads per inch, that's how far you adjust it. What's that?
That's 10 threads per inch.
0.03?
That you're cutting. You just said 16.
Thank you for catching that. So it's 0.0, let me check my cheat sheets, 0.05, I think.
So you're going to cut the whole thread in a single pass?
I'm going to have to go on memory, so we'll hope it's right, because I was planning on cutting originally with 16. So I think it's 0.055. So we're going to mark right here, and I never can remember which way it goes, forward or backwards, so we're going to go counterclockwise, and I'm going to put my finger, because Bob doesn't have a little arrow on his, to move this thing. But basically, we're going to turn it one full revolution, right? Isn't that what you did for the 10? One full revolution?
Is one full revolution.
But, I mean, that's what we're going to turn is one full revolution. So it's 0.01, 0.02, this is 0.05.
Be that precise, just eyeball.
Just come back to 0.0.
All those little tick marks are just because I could. You don't need them.
Yeah, they confuse me. Now I can't remember where I was. Here, let's start over.
Yeah, you know. It's a decoration. It's like all those extra lights on the computer.
Okay.
Just blink.
0.015. 0.015. Counterclockwise. 0.015. Okay. There we go. All right. Now, the speed we want to turn this at is about as fast as this lathe will go. So we're going to cut this thing at about 2,500.
It's sort of like looking into a reactor compartment.
One more. Okay. I think I got it. Okay, there we go.
It's not fastest speed.
I don't want the fastest. I want 2,500, 2,630. In this case, closest thing 2,500 is 2,630, and that's close enough for government work. So if you see, you can see that the cutter is definitely outside the wood. So as we start threading into it, we're going to be cutting some threads. Fire in a hole. Now, it pays to keep your left hand on here just to stabilize it, reduce some of the vibration. It also keeps your hand from getting someplace where you don't want it to be, because that's quite a meat cutter. You go slow, because you don't need to get in a big hurry.
Speed really doesn't matter.
No, it's the threads on this thing. It really affects it. On some woods, I guess, if you go too slow, like a router, you could burn them. I haven't had that happen, but I understand it can. You go too fast, you're more likely to have a tendency to crumble or get rough threads. So you don't want to get in a big hurry.
Yeah,
that cutter has a lot more edges than a router bit, though, so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It had what, six or eight?
Well, I can tell we're going to have to take another pass. The other, the my design, I like to cut on the other side because you can see it more easily when you're leaning over. So you cut it off, back it out. And we can see there's really heavy flats on it, so I've got to go a little bit further. How much, you know, it's kind of an educated guess.
Till the flats get skinny.
Till the flats get skinny. A little trial and error. Going to be a certain amount of play, and the rod is not a finely machined piece of metal, but it is just wood. It will still work. It really will work. Now I can look at this. I still got some flats. Probably want to take one more pass, but we're not going to have time to do both threads and fit, but I'm going to pass this around. You can see it. You can see it cuts, cuts pretty good threads, and they're fairly even. Well, that's, you know, cost, commercial jig, somewhere around $400 to $500 plus shipping. But that gives you, that'll get you in the ballpark, about $400, $415, I think, for Bonnie Klein, $399 or $499 for a thread master, depending on whether the limitations on a three, for the first one. After that, yeah, you amortize over a lot of boxes. And you compare that to about $75 to put one of these together for one coarse rod. When you add another adapter, and it kicks up a little bit more, I think.
Well, we priced those out with two.
Did we get it for 70? Did we come out about 75? Okay, so we did both of them for $75. So you can actually probably get it down to about 60 if you just want to go with a six
Does that include
one. That includes the cutter.
Really?
Yeah, and I think the collet. The rod is real cheap. The nuts aren't too bad. The problem comes in when you start buying these nuts, it's like you got to buy them in a pack of 25. Unless one vendor sells them in stainless steel, and they're a lot more per nut, but if you're only buying five nuts, it's a lot cheaper.
Can you check at Home Depot and buy nuts?
No.
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 Not 16 thread. 10
no.
Thread.
No.
You got to go to Ace Hardware to get those.
Can't go to Handy Ace.
You can go to different places, but I can tell you some of these are not. Some of you wind up having to order, and I can't remember. I think it's the 16. 16 was tougher to find.
12 is tough to find.
The threading jig is really pretty easy. I mean, it's a pretty low learning curve, and once you get it, you get pretty much perfect threads every time. It's not rocket science. Where you got to develop that skill and keep that skill up with hand chasing.
What's the thread that, or the nut or whatever that the rod is going through? You got a nut buried
two
in
regular
there?
Nuts.
Two nuts. Just like this.
One's
just like this nut right here.
One's adjustable.
One's adjustable, so you can take some of the slack out of it. With the threading jig, you can cut most hardwoods. With the hand threading, it's much more limited. The perfect threads every time versus, to me, hand thread chasing is just more fun. Now, this is a nice way to go, and like I said, we're going to, in the article that's coming out, it's got the sources for the parts, how much we paid for it, and how you put it together, and some of the idiosyncrasies. Now, just in the mail today, I got this present that I treated myself to because I was really getting into threading. So there's a guy in the UK that makes these things. and sells them on eBay. For the grand price of about 85 pounds.
What is that exchange?
It's about $1.62 a pound, or $1.64, depends on the day. Plus shipping. Shipping is about 25 pounds. But for that, so I paid about $175, but it went up just a little bit here at the first of the year. But it's a very nicely machined product, but it works a little different. Instead of having this fancy base for the Bonnie Klein, kind of like this one where it mounts on the lathe, this one mounts in the banjo. Now, it won't mount on this one because I ordered this with a post for a Powermatic.
That's an inch.
Yeah, but it bottoms, it hits. Yeah. You can't use Powermatic fittings on here. So what you do, you asked about how do you line it up. Believe it or not, you just line it up by sight to see if it's parallel. And that's close enough because you're only traversing a short distance. So it's not like if you're off a little bit, you know, if you were going out 1,000 yards, it'd be a little different story. But he's machined this rod. It's not coarse rod. He's got this machined. This post threads in here, and it comes in, believe it or not, a little padded envelope about as big as the box is around, but it's only about that thick. I mean, it's amazing. Look at it, with lots and lots and lots of stamps. And it comes with a cutter. Turns out, I thought, how can this guy do this? He manufactures his own cutters. I looked at it, it's like, whoa, this is kind of interesting. It's not quite as nifty looking as that, but I think it'll get the job done. So it comes with a cutter. So it's less than half the price of the cheapest commercial jig you get here. And he doesn't sell it in any store, not here in Great Britain. You got to go on eBay. And you got to do a search for thread cutting tool. If you go thread cutting jig, it may not show up. It's real hard to find. So I don't know how much business he's getting because it's hard to stumble on it even.
How many different threads is he offering?
He offers one. This is like the Ford, the old original. 16. Yeah, that's right, because I've corresponded with Bill. And he actually had some tips that were useful to me, because it just came in the mail today and I assembled it. So Bill, that question, that's such a dumb question. I'm going to ask my chauffeur in the back.
The thing about it, adapter fit only one way.
Oh, thank you for everybody. Yeah, that was a neat feature he's added to this, is the nose piece. I think I've got to take the set screw off. This nose piece here is threaded for 3/4 inch by 10 threads per inch. So what that means is you can put it on your one-way or Powermatic live center and have a free-spinning adapter that'll hold a chuck and use it to center reverse turn, set up a bowl like on a vacuum chuck. You just take it off and move that apparatus over here. If you went to buy that whole apparatus, from one way, it's about $40-$45 or something.
Yeah, PSI adapters we're using do the same thing.
What's that? Yeah.
I said you deduct the $45
right.
For the adapter,
yeah.
$40 for the cutter.
Yeah.
That makes it about $70.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know how he does it, and the machining on it looks to me to be pretty good. I mean, this thing is tight. It's real tight. Did you have a hard time turning the traversing mechanism? Mine's just real tight. I put a little spray on mine, and it made it a little easier, and I think it'll loosen up with time. But it's got a collar on it. You set the collar, and you just pop it in there, and boom, it stops at the right height. You just look at it like this and say, yep, that's parallel.
you put your cutter in there.
A little bit untapered.
Line the cutter up with the back of it and move it to the front. If it's a little off, you just make a little dug.
Now, the one difference is here, the Bonnie Klein and the Baxter have a calibrated traversing knob. And depending on the head is how many revolutions or how many tick marks you turn to get the right side thread. With his, he does it backwards. You do the male thread, then you measure, if I understand it right, you measure inside the thread, right?
I do the female thread first.
Okay, so you just flip-flop it. Okay, so it's the same thing. But you use a measurement off one to make the tenon on the other one, similar to what I was doing on the thing. And then you set it up, and you have it touching the wood, and then the direction says you turn one revolution. And I think Bill found out it takes more like one and a quarter or one and a third. Yeah, so there's a little bit of a learning curve. The documentation is weak, to be kind. It's a more complex mechanism than I think the. Anyhow, it's one page, half of it's pictures. He doesn't explain how anything works, other than you put it on there and you turn it and it works. I mean, it's very, very simplistic. But hey, it's real cheap and it looks like it'll work real well.
It sets up real easy too.
It's fast setup.
Yeah, no
compact.
Problem.
Yeah, and compact. Yeah, you could actually break it down for going to a demo or something if you want. Just unthread the post. Everything has got all these set screws. It even gives you an Allen wrench to for every screw that's on there. Any questions on anything I've covered? I appreciate y'all's attention. Hope it was useful. Yeah, who's going to go out and cut threads?
I'm down to making my urn. How much are you going to charge me to thread the damn thing?
Let's see how much I got left to pay on this thing.
You gotta ask Bill, you can't afford it.
We could probably work something out. I've made my urn. I didn't bring it because it was so big, but it looks just like that little one except bigger. I posted a picture of it on Facebook and got some strange comments. My sister says, that's kind of creepy. Yeah, she likes it.
So she'll keep that.
Who knows?
Might wind up floating down the Chattahoochee River.
Depends on who goes first.
A minimum quantity of volume, isn't it?
Yeah, it's about 3/4 of gallon for a male, man. About 3/4 for a typical male. Right. But as a practical term, about 3/4 of a gallon is about 180 pounds.
What about the opening?
It's got to be big enough to pour, to put in a plastic bag, because you sack it. You don't want to drop the urn and have Grandpa go all over the floor. So you do put a plastic bag. I learned this from Phil McMullen's, Clark McMullen, thank you, his demo. So if you can put a bag in there and you got an opening, and it depends on whether the crematorium pulverizes it or whether it's got bigger chunks, maybe an inch and a half. Inch and a half is probably a pretty good size. Okay.
Very good.